Hi everyone, welcome back to Workshop. Yes, it's been quite a while since I did a video, just been busy with other projects, but hopefully I'm back on track again and I can start to bring in some more videos to YouTube, repairs and that sort of thing. And to get things going in 2017, I've got my own 3630 compressor, dual channel compressor here. This is actually the unit that I have in the house actually. It sits below the TV between our satellite receiver box and the amplifier that I've got in the living room. Prior to not having this unit, I don't know what it is with Sky TV in the UK here, but some channels are a lot louder than others. Some of them have got very little bass, some of them have got, you know, too much. It just seems to be quite wild, the difference between the various channels or the programs that are on those channels. So for the past couple of years, I've had this compressor sitting between the skybox and the amplifier, and it basically controls the volume, any peaks, that sort of thing that happen on the audio signal. It controls that sound before it goes to the amplifier, and it does actually make for a much better listening experience to the satellite TV. If the truth be told, I'm not that sensitive to the sound differences. It's the wife that is. It's probably because I'm a little bit deaf and I like the TV just that little bit louder, and obviously get gunshots in movies and that sort of thing. It can be quite a noise coming from the amplifier, a bit too loud for the wife. So I've had this compressor on the system and it's a lot better. So it's a dual channel unit. I've zoomed in on the left hand side here, obviously dual channel because of the stereo audio signal. I'm using it as a left and a right, obviously. And basically what you've got is two independent, fully featured compressors in the one rack space, and that gives you control over ratios, thresholds, attack and decay controls to customize the compression response. Because effectively what this unit's doing is detecting high gains or high volumes and pulling back on that volume, and you can control things like how much it's going to pull back and how fast it pulls back, how fast it releases it back again. So you've got all these controls over here, and you've also got a gate at the right hand side here. That's handy for if you've got any background noise floor that you want to mask off, where you can sort of get rid of that on the gate. That's not really going to be used in the house. There's not too much of a problem with background floor noise in the house, but you know, these units here are designed for a sound man working with live bands, and in that scenario you can get quite a bit of background noise that you might want to just filter out effectively, or gate it out there. So this unit sits below the TV, has done for the past couple of years, just bought it second hand off of eBay, but it's developed a fault. The left hand side works fine, the right hand side, as far as the compressor, etc., it works fine. However, what I've noticed is that the audio output from the right-hand side has lost all its bottom end. All the bass component of the audio signal is basically gone, and it's really toppy and tinny on the output. And even if you bypass the compressor, there's a button here on each channel for bypassing the compressor, so effectively it should just have a straight through signal. Even that signal there is affected, so there's something wrong inside the unit on the right hand channel only, and that's what we're going to fix today. The other thing I'm going to do is this unit here is, it's not the best of compressors. It's a cheap and cheerful one really, and they're not renowned for having the nicest sound on the output there. So I'm going to go through a little bit of an upgrade as part of the repair, and what that involves is changing a few of the components inside, upgrading some of the op amps and the voltage controlled amplifiers inside the unit as well, upgrading them, a few capacitors as well, and hopefully it should improve the sound. There has been reports on net, other people have done this, it does make quite a good difference, and basically brings this cheap and cheerful Alesis compressor up to a more of the mid-range range compressors. So that'll be great for the audio experience on my TV. So let's open her up. So I've already removed the screws, three screws on the top and three on the bottom, and I've removed the nuts on the back of the connectors, the quarter inch jacks in the back there, and it's ready to pull apart. Well, I think the sides come off. Like I said, these things are designed to be rack mounted, and when you do get them, they come up a couple of lugs at the ends there for obviously putting into the rack mount. I'd actually removed them, so I'd actually just hacked them off here because it looked a bit unsightly below the TV. I'd rather have a box format that for sitting below the TV, so I cut them off. So that's that. And here we go. Put that over at one side. So it's a very, very typical design here of audio gear from, I guess this unit probably dates to the 90s, something like that. I mean, it's all through hole, but they tended to be that way quite late on. So what you've got here, you can see that, if I could just get it there. You can see you've got two identical channels, more or less. There are amplifiers and op-amps down in there, and the same at there, it's almost a carbon copy. And then over at the right hand side here, we've got a power supply circuit, and there's a second PCB that looks to interface to all the push buttons and the LEDs here on the front. So looking at the back of the unit there, you've got the two channels there, it's almost an identical copy of all the electronics there. On for both sides there, and you've got this power supply section at this end of the board here, and there's a little ribbon cable there which has been sealed down that goes up onto the top board there, which is also sealed down there. These things can get thrown around quite a bit, you know, they're meant for rack mounted, and they're usually in little cases that get wheeled around for live audio bands and stuff like that, so they do get, you know, they get quite a lot of abuse, so it's good to see that it was actually sealed down, those little connectors. So I think we'll have a look at the power supply section first and see what we can find there. So this is the input here. It just comes from what's supposed to be a 9-volt adapter. Comes in there, you've got four diodes, bridge rectifier obviously, and then there's a couple of regulators there, a 7815 and a 7915, so that's giving me plus and minus 15 on the board there. And you've got two brass pillars there which are used to hold down the regulators, and also I would guess to act as a little bit of a heat sink there, because if we look a little bit closely, there is some discolorization. The PCB is actually quite discolored there, so these things are probably getting quite warm. And underneath there, I think you can see there are two capacitors there. If you look closely, I don't know if you can see that on camera, but those capacitors are leaking down onto the PCB. There's gunk coming out the bottom of them, and it's leaking onto the PCB. And looking on the back of the board, those two capacitors there would appear to be on the input to the two regulators there. So whether that's causing my problem or not, or the right-hand channel, I don't really know. I would have thought that if there was any problem with the power supply, it would have affected both channels, but you never know. The channel that's actually gone down is the one, let me think, around that way it was that channel. The channel that's gone down is the one closest to the power supply. So I just wonder if it's experiencing more noise than the one at the far end, because maybe there's further decoupling capacitors on the power supply down at that end of the board, and it's not quite affecting that board there, or whether there's more heat up at this end of the board here and it's affected some of the other components on the board there, I don't really know, or whether we've just got some other fault there. But obviously I'll have replaced those capacitors there. I've got a couple extra capacitors there. Those are just on the basically the output from the bridge rectifier before it goes away off to the input of the regulators, where you've got those additional capacitors there. So there's quite a lot of decoupling on the input there, and obviously you're going to need that for an audio device like this. It's got to be as smooth as possible, really. You don't want any background noise on the audio signal. Okay, so let's measure some voltages now. I've got the multimeter hooked up with the unit on and plugged in. This is the plus 15 volts DC. Yeah, 15.1. This is its input, 23.2. Down on the negative one, this is the output, minus 15. And the input, minus 27. That's a hell of a volt drop across those regulators there. Yeah, these brass pillars here are absolutely roasting. You can't touch them. There's not a big enough heat sink on those regulators, so I think I'm probably going to have to do something with that as well. It's not much wonder the circuit board down there is actually discoloured there. It's yellowed the circuit board, what with the heat. And yeah, the rectifier diodes are they're warm, but I'm sure that's probably just because it's picking up heat off of that regulators there. But yes, and even the capacitor is absolutely roasting. We're going to have to do something about that. So next thing to do is strip it down even further, and let's change out those two capacitors for a start, and let's try and do something about the heat sinking on the regulators there. And there we are, stripped down, both boards separated from each other, and I've now got good access to the circuit board where I'll be making most of the mods. And the other one here, don't plan on touching at all. This is basically just the digital indication bar graphs here, and also reading the switches and the ports and all the rest of it. So nothing really to do here. We're down on the main board. So let's have a look at the power supply. Okay, raking through the old heatsink box here, the smaller heatsinks that I've got, trying to see if there's anything suitable that I could use on those two regulators. And I have actually got an idea. I've picked this out of the box here. Now, one thing to be aware of with the 7915, let me just zoom in a bit. A 7915 and a 7815, the tabs on those regulators are not connected to the same potential. On the 7815, they're always the centre pin on the TO220 package, but on the 7915, the input and the ground connection in the middle are swapped over. So effectively, the tab on your 7915 is actually your negative supply to the regulator. And of course, on the 7815, it's your centre pin, so it's your ground connection. So there are two different potentials there, so I cannot use a single heatsink and have them shorted together. I'd release the magic smoke if I did that. So what I propose to do is I'm going to cut this heatsink here, probably around about here, into two small strips. I'm going to make two heatsink, two small strips, and they're effectively going to sit upside down like that. I'll drill one hole there, and there's your heatsink there, just sort of pointing down the way. It's not ideal, but it's extra heat sink that's going to help dissipate that heat away. And I'll just do the same on this one here, and obviously there'll be air gapped in the middle there to not short out. These pillars here don't have threaded holes in the top, so I'll rake through my parts bin and I'll probably have to replace them. I don't think I've got anything as wide, so my pillar that I'll replace it with probably going to be a little bit thinner, and it's maybe not going to conduct the heat as good as these ones will. But we'll just have to see what I can do there. It's got to be better than what it was anyway. And of course, at the same time, I'm going to replace those two caps. And what a mess. Bottom of the caps there just leaked out something terrible and onto the PCB there. So I clean up first of all, and let's get those caps replaced. Just noticed as well, 1000 microfarad. 25 volt. Now, what was I getting on one of those voltages there across the regulator? It was a tad more than 25 volts. Anyway, I'm going to replace them with these two here. 1000 microfarad, 50 volts. A little bit taller, I think. I'll have to see if they would fit in. Okay, so I've just put the two PCBs back together again temporarily. And let's see where the cap's going to fit. just, I think, just going to go in there. Luckily, there's no components on this top side of the board which would interfere with the top of the cap there, so I think it's just going to fit in and no more. Okay, there's my two new heat sinks hacked on, two replacement pillars, replaced the caps like I said. I've also replaced the two caps on the output of the regulators. Not the ideal scenario where I've basically surrounded the output caps in a hot heat sink, but we'll just see how hot they get anyway. And whilst that's heating up, I'll let that go. I'm actually going to test the ESR of the caps I took out. So here's my ESR meter here. I've got a reference cap on at the moment, just one from stock. There you go, 913 microfarad with an ESR of 0.01. So let's take that off and grab one of the ones I removed. This is one of the ones where the electrolyte was pouring out of it. Get that one there. 12.2 microfarad, 39.5 ohms. Wow. Wow. Okay, it's been powered up now for about 10 minutes with the new heat sinks on. I've also gone ahead and changed those two caps there, and I can touch the heat sinks now and the pillars. I mean, before they were just untouchable. Still hot, so you know, I'll have a look around and see if I've got a adapter with a slightly lower voltage, because I'm not convinced that's the original adapter. It's just the one I received with the unit, but it's a no-name brand that's on it, so I'm not convinced it's the right one. I do think it's maybe rather high on its output voltage, and it's therefore it's stressing the regulators there and giving them a lot of heat, but it's definitely a lot cooler than it was, and worst comes to worst, it's probably okay as it is. Yeah, I can definitely touch even the package themselves with my finger. It's still hot, but it's not as hot as it was. So now I think I'll take a look at some of the other caps on the board. I'll maybe move one or two at random and just have a look and see what their ESR is, just in case they need replacing as well. I was just away there to look at the other capacitors across the supply to some of the op-amps, etc. I mean, because these TLO84s are taking the plus and minus 15 from the regulators, both of them there. And I went to the back of the board to trace out the supply capacitors, and it's weird because some of the joints in the back of this board have been touched up. The other ones are as original and as clean from when it came out the factory. And it's odd, but the supply capacitors, for instance, here's a TLO84 here, and looking on the back of the board there, you've got a couple of electrolytic capacitors there. Those joints have been touched up, those two there. So I think, and it was like that all over the board, you know, looking at some of the other ones down here, there's the two joints there that have been touched up. That's, you know, one of those capacitors there, you know, and down here, here's the other TLO84 here. Look, this capacitor here, probably across the supply, it is pin 11, so it's across the supply there. Those two joints have been touched up as well, so I think somebody's had a go at this before at some point and replaced, or at least taken off those supply capacitors, those decoupling capacitors there. Perhaps, you know, this unit's had a fault before and it's overheated, etc., etc., and maybe that's, they've been changed out before. Now, I have changed out a couple of the capacitors. I took one or two off and they were okay. ESR was a little bit high. I've got a couple of them, one of them here. ESR was, you know, is nearly 0.1, you know, maybe it's just because it's cheap capacitors, I don't know, but I've replaced them for something a little bit better, which is directly across one of the supply rails on both of those op-amps there. The rest of them I'm just going to leave. Right, the next thing I'm going to do is change out the two op-amps that are on the board there. This one on channel 2 and this one on channel 1 for something slightly better. They've just got basically TLO84s on them. I'm going to put something a bit better there. I'm also going to change out these voltage control amplifiers here. There's two single and nine packages there. It's got a THAT2150 there, and you've also got similar for the other channel there. THAT2150 do a 2180. It's a slightly higher spec unit, which has a lower distortion figures, higher dynamic range, that sort of thing there. So I'm going to change those out as well. And hopefully that'll result in a slightly better compressor. So I've hooked up my Hantech SigGen there, and I've got it set. I'm going to sweep from about 100 hertz up to 1 kilohertz on the control there, and let's see what it does on the board. What I've gone ahead and done is I've hooked it up to the input onto both channels, and I'm going to scope the output from both channels, and we'll see what happens. So there we are on the scope. This is the input. Oh, let me just adjust that. That's the input on channel 1, and that's the input on channel 2, both the same. So now I'll scope the output from channel 1. Now I've got the compressor set to bypass position, which basically means none of the front panel controls, the knobs on the front there, do anything. The amplitude control, nothing does anything. It's in total bypass condition. So there is the output from channel 1. So go back on input again, and onto the output, and it's carbon copy more or less. It's exactly what we want to see. Now if I adjust amplitude control, I'm still on the output here, does absolutely nothing. So now we'll go into the input to channel 2, good, perfect signal, and now the output from channel 2, and you can see there's definite problem there. Now I'm currently feeding in a 100 hertz sine wave, so now if I start increasing that frequency now, let me just adjust the scope. I'm now up at 1 kilohertz there. 2 kilohertz. And you can see that the amplitude is changing. It's starting to go up as I increase the frequency there. And that sort of correlates against what I was experiencing in real life when the unit was below the TV. Remember what I said at the start, when the higher frequencies seem to be coming through and I'd lost all bottom end, and you can see that kind of goes the same as what I'm getting here. Now if I go back onto the working channel, there's the output from it. The amplitude has just stayed totally constant. I'm at 4 kilohertz now. I'll start dropping the frequency down. 900 hertz. Oh, let me just get that going there. There we go. 300 hertz, and the amplitude staying absolutely spot on. Again, here's the input, and there's the output. Now back onto the faulty channel. Definite problem there. Now the other thing I have done, I have wiggled connections, flexed the board, especially the switches on the unit there for the bypass, etc. I have played around with them, and I don't think there's any problem with a dodgy connection. I do think there is some electronic fault somewhere. Okay, I fixed it off camera there, and it didn't take very long at all. I found the culprit, and it was this little electrolytic capacitor here. What actually happened was I received the replacement op amp and the voltage controlled amplifier from Farnell's. I stuck them onto both channels. You can see the new IC there and the new voltage controlled amplifier there, both socketed, and I've done the same on the other channel, powered it up, scoped the output, and it was still exactly the same, so I knew it wasn't a semiconductor problem there anyway. So I started having a look around, and I thought, well, there's not much else that can go wrong. It's a pretty simple circuit. Now I don't have a schematic diagram, so I was working quite blind, and I started looking at the electrolytic capacitors round about the op amp, and this one here, if I can just zoom in a little bit, wrong way. This one here happens to be between the output of one of the op amps in this quad package here and the input of the voltage controlled amplifier. So I thought, I'll just go ahead and change that capacitor there just for no reason other than that, and bingo, as soon as I scope it, it's perfect. Right, So I'm on the input to both channels, channel 1, channel 2. This is the output from the working one over to the output of the faulty channel, and I've got a nice sine wave of the correct amplitude there. So that's it working. And I can wiggle around the capacitors and the op amp there around about that area just to make sure it wasn't any intermittent fault. But there was no broken tracks, there was no dodgy joints. I just think that capacitor was well past its sell-by. Looking at the board, of course, I did notice, I did mention earlier, it looked like somebody'd been in this board before and upgraded or replaced a lot of the electrolytic capacitors anyway. That was one of the ones that wasn't replaced, so whether it was missed for any reason back when somebody else was inside this the unit, I don't know. So I've upgraded the op amp, I've upgraded the voltage controlled amplifier, I've changed out a few of the electrolytic capacitors, I've fixed the power supply, so I think it's actually time to put it back together again and see how it performs. And there it is, back below the TV. I hope you can see this because it is pretty dark, but there's my amplifier at the bottom there, I've got a graph equalizer, and then there's the compressor installed back where it should do. I can't demo it, I can't play any music through it, or YouTube will just detect that and they may just pull the video or worse, so I can't really demo it, but I have tested it in bypass mode and I've tested it in its normal compression mode, and it's doing exactly what it should do, and both channels are sounding exactly the same. Whether it sounds any better at all, that's yet to be seen. It's hard to tell unless you can do an immediate before and after, which I wasn't able to do, of course, but I'll tell when I get the music up loud, probably later on in the week when it's less late in the evening, but for now, quite happy that it's back up and running. Quite happy as well that I've managed to do something about the heatsink, because that was running hot. Whether that's the original power supply, like I said earlier, I don't really know. It's supposed to be 9 volts, but it's giving out about 11 volts AC. Maybe that's just a tad high, as could be seen with the voltage across some of those capacitors. So I may try to get hold of a 9 volt AC power supply. In fact, I've probably got one lying around. But for the moment, that seems to be another successful repair. Thanks for watching.